Welcome. I'm Jon Caldara, president of the Independence Institute and your devil's advocate. A couple weeks ago, we had this terrific election. Well, terrific for me, but lots of things happened. Tax increases went down. School reformers got their bans on fracking passed. So to figure out the fallout politically, let's talk to a couple people in the know. Miller Hudson, who's a consultant, longtime political hack, and hell, I really know what you do for a living. You just exist around the Capitol for some reason.
That's right. I say I work part-time. Yeah. It fools everyone.
It fools everyone. And from the Denver Post editorial page, Alicia Caldwell, thank you for being here.
Thanks for having
me. What surprised you about the results, first of all? Anything?
I actually wasn't that surprised. No, I think some of the school board elections and the turnovers there were things I didn't see coming, but I wasn't looking for them either.
I was surprised by the gap in 66, yeah. Meaning that between those who voted for it and those who voted against it, I thought that with a $10 to $12 million campaign, it would not be 30 points. That was, to me, that was shocking.
Yeah, and we ran the educational campaign against it at Independence. I was with the group, the issue committee that fought it, and as it grew by, I got more and more optimistic. I never expected 65% no vote. What were people saying with a 65% no vote? And will the Denver Post editorial page ever, you know, join them sometime?
I think people, as the election drew closer, I think people started looking at that calculator and really envisioning what this would mean on a monthly basis to them. I think that's part of it. Second, I thought it was very intelligent and complex measure, and I think it was oversimplified in the messaging, and I'm not sure people knew entirely what was in it. I would have expected there to be more about the equity portion of this amendment, of this constitutional amendment, as opposed to, you know, more art in schools. I didn't think that was really emblematic.
Oh, but come on. It's not like they had the resources to be able to get out such a message. And when you only have $12 million, that's not much. This was the most expensive tax increase campaign in Colorado history. I've never seen $12 million, and I can't believe that it bombed so big.
$1 billion is a lot of money. And in Colorado, I knew this thing was in trouble last spring. I was at the downtown Democratic Forum breakfast, and it was brought up, and about half the people in the room were saying, what do they need $1 billion for?
So the Democratic?
These were the Democrats that were concerned about how much money was involved. And they never put it in proportion to what was already being spent or who was going to get the money or why it was necessary to do this beyond, you know, kind of the feel-good stuff Alicia's talking about, you know, we'll have more music and PE and art. And nobody thinks that that's the problem with our schools right now. I mean, you might
be disappointed. I'm lobbying to get rid of those things in schools. getting back into the minds a little sooner. Let's talk a little bit about the fallout, though. Mm-hmm. Let me make this observation. John Hickenlooper and I have tangled over many tax increases, and usually Mr. Hickenlooper wins. This time, he didn't. You know, this is a guy who rode the trolley for RTD's fast tracks. He jumped out of an airplane to poke a hole in Tabor. The guy was running around with A through I characters on the streets of Colorado for the property tax increase. He wore a blue bear outfit to raise the tourism taxes. Mm-hmm. I didn't see any of that. I saw none of it. The man put it on the ballot. He signed Senate Bill 213. He was there at the beginning. He said he was all in. Am I not observing something, or was he missing an action?
Well, but that, you know, that was a different stage. That was Denver as opposed to the entire state.
Referendum C was the entire state, and jumping out of the airplane made a huge difference.
That's true.
That's why it snuck
by.
It
was helpful. There's absolutely no doubt about that. But you know what, John? I think that if Amendment 66 had passed, it would be worse on Hickenlooper than if it failed.
Yeah. How?
Well, people would get a tax bill come January, and all of a sudden, whoa, take a look at this. You know, I think there's a strong argument to be made there that that he might have faced some political liability for having helped put that into effect.
Well, why would he take the chance in any way?
Because he believed in it.
Knowing that it's going to
Because he believed in the educational equity of it, is what I think. I haven't spoken to him about it, but there was a lot good in that bill. I know you didn't like it at all, not liking most taxes, but there was a lot, I thought, that was positive to address the changing demographics of Colorado.
But those don't require $1 billion. Reforms don't require more money. It requires reforms, and there's a lot of tough things that need to
be done. Some reforms do. Sorry,
Miller. But I think to get to the issue of his support, I don't think he was ever really the ringleader in this circus. Johnston wanted to reform the School Finance Act.
Senator Michael Johnston.
And it's 40 years out of date, and some of the fixes that were proposed.
No, 20 years. It was done 1994.
Well, there's pieces of that formula that go back 38 years ago when I was in the legislature.
Oh, my God. Written on tablets.
Yes, that's right. Carved in stone. But I think there's a larger problem for the governor. And in one of the reasons Referendum C worked, and I know you didn't like Ref C either, but at least everybody was in the boat. You had a Republican governor in the boat. You had the Democratic Speaker of the House. They baked a big cake, and they gave everybody a slice. Transportation got a slice. Higher ed got a slice. K-12 got a slice. And that probably is not attractive to you, but the fact is that's the way to sell a tax increase. I know people, because I've been involved in the transportation area, sat on their hands on 66. They looked at it much like you did. If it passes, we'll never get any more money for highways, because voters will understandably say, we just gave you $1 billion. Why are you back asking for more money? Now, I would argue that win or lose, this is a problem for anybody that wants to raise taxes in the next year or two, because if you can't get people to vote for taxes for K-12, are they really going to vote
for roads or health care or other things that doesn't? Yeah. Well, talk to me about John Hickenlooper, though. He's facing re-election next year, and he did not have a good session. That is, he paid a heavy political price for his stance on guns, historic recalls, maybe a third one coming. He angered rural Colorado with the electric mandate, and I'm still baffled by his either inability or unwillingness to make a decision on Nathan Dunlap while we're talking about gun violence. And you can go either way on the death penalty, and both sides have really strong moral points, but the man couldn't make a decision. And these, I would imagine these things are going to come back to bite him, and now this loss. Does this pile on? Is he vulnerable, or is he vulnerable soon?
I think we're in a period where all incumbents are always vulnerable, that there's so much ill feeling and animosity towards what is viewed as a rigged system, a rigged economic system, a rigged political system, that all incumbents have to be careful. So they're always vulnerable. What works in Hickenlooper's favor is that he has to run against a Republican candidate for governor in Colorado.
And it's only if we can pick one. Only if we can pick one, and that's not too likely anymore. So
right. So I mean, but could the right candidate with the right message beat him? Of course.
Now, you were pretty strong on the governor in your column in the Statesman. That he has to change some things right away.
I think he should. I think that would send the right signal to voters. That would kind of preclude a.
What does he need to do, from your point of view, if you are his consultant?
Well, I think he has to completely shake up his political operation, because the folks that he's been using are bought into this democratic model of micro-targeting. You can win every election by just identifying, the 25 to 35-year-old single mom with two or more kids, and we know what she cares about, and we get flog her until she goes to
the
polls.
Give her that message about kids.
Right. And I think that what number 66 proved is you can't win that way. Not all the time, anyway. It worked in a national election for the Obama campaign, but I don't think when you get down to the state or the local level that this might, it didn't save Angela Hirono or John Morse their Senate seats.
So, talk to me about John Hickenlooper. I mean, he's he is the governor. And whatever rolls up to his desk, it might be Senator Johnston's bill, but it was the governor who's going to have to deal with it next year.
Well, and he also, I think, in this upcoming legislative session, needs to do some front-end managing if it, you know, if it remains a democratically controlled legislature. You know, Morgan Carroll is pretty liberal over in the Senate, and it, you know, it doesn't portend. He needs to have non-controversial stuff come to his desk in the run-up to the election. I think that is, you know, that is key to not having another rural electric standard gun control measure kind of session for him. But, you know, you can't really control those guys necessarily.
Well, it's a lot easier now. Morgan Carroll might be a hardcore progressive, but there's two less Democratic votes. True. All you need to do now in that Senate is swing one moderate Democrat, and it can save Hickenlooper from having to make those decisions. I mean, the best time that Hick had was when the Republicans had a one-seat majority in the House, and all that silliness that got there last session never made it there
before. Well, and there was the fight over civil unions that, you know, where he could take the high road on it and fight the Republican sort of thing. And it may not, and I wrote a column about this, and I have nothing against D.B. Hudak, really. I don't think she's done anything to merit a recall. But if she were to be recalled and the control would flip, then, you know, Hickenlooper would be far less likely to get the kind of measures that might cause him some trouble at the polls.
So you think? So you're telling me that Hickenlooper is going to be out there with the petition pad for?
I might
save my career.
I'd be surprised to see him get involved.
You know. Really?
That's well,
no, he does have to manage the political agenda that's coming up this year. He's got to sit down with the Senate president and the speaker and get some agreement on stuff he doesn't want to see get to his desk. And that means being hard-nosed, and it may involve taking some Democrats aside and saying, we'll veto your bill, whatever's important to you.
He wouldn't veto a single bill.
No, he didn't.
A single bill last
right.
year.
He's got to start vetoing bills. Veto is for two purposes. One is to kill really bad ideas, and the other is to discipline your own party. And he's got to learn how to discipline people in his own party.
Just as an aside, the last two governors seem to have managerial issues. I mean, Ritter is a wonderful man. I mean, he's a good guy, but he could not run the ship. And I think part of it is because he wasn't raised in the in the Capitol. He wasn't a legislator, he wasn't around that, he was part of the city. And the same thing now with the governor, he was a mayor. And, you know, what it takes to run the legislative branch and work with the legislature and work, run the operation is a whole different skill set. I look at Bill Owens, who ran a tight ship, and Roy Romer before him, and even Dick Lamb. These guys ran, they ran a ship, and I get a sense with Hick that he would just, you know, things would come out to his desk and he'd take a swing at him, and he didn't control the agenda. Am I off on that?
Well, I'm not sure that he needed to, and I mean, perhaps he did this last session. He probably would have benefited from what I think of as an enforcer, you know, just sort of saying, don't send this stuff to me, it's going to be political dynamite. But, you know, he also took care of some of the issues that, you know, people who elected him care about. You know, so it's kind of a 50-50 kind of thing.
I think it's important to remember one calendar year is like 10,000 geologic years.
Well, that's true.
In politics.
Absolutely.
And by next November, what happened in the last session will be like the Neolithic era. Yeah. And it's really going to be what happens over the next 6 months that is going to determine whether he's vulnerable or not. But he needs to control that over the next 6 months. And the adjustment that I think has been difficult for John is that he was in a strong mayor form of government where he could always break the arms of people on city council. They needed 3/4 vote to overrule anything that he did. You operate in that environment for 8 years and things run pretty smoothly.
Right.
And you come over to the Capitol, and it's not that way.
Wait a second. Didn't I just say that?
Yes.
All right. So bring it to the Republican side. Are Republicans licking their chops a little prematurely? I mean, I think after this election, you know, Republicans feel like, man, we can do this, and I worry about that because my team, we don't play well together. Is it too soon for Republicans to be encouraged?
I think it's far too soon. Don't ever underestimate John Hickenlooper. He's a very good politician, a very good policymaker. You know, I would not, I don't know who among the group of four that has emerged now, Mike Kopp, Scott Gessler, Greg Brophy, help me out with
Tom
the fourth
Tancredo.
One, Tancredo. How could I forget Tancredo?
How could you?
I'm not sure who among them could win the general election. So, you know, I'm not, it's not a great setup for the Republicans.
What's your advice for Republicans?
My advice to Republicans, find somebody likable. You know, I mean, it's really important
Cops
in politics
likeable.
To be likable. Yeah. You know, they've had a pattern, say, the last 6 or 8 years of nominating people that just aren't likable. And John is eminently likable.
There's no debating that. Hey, let's switch gears a little bit. For me, 66 was something I worked on, but it's something that I also tried our best to get the word out on was those Dougco school board races, where the Denver Post got it right once on some endorsements. And the reformers stayed in office in a seat where the unions might have spent up to $2 million. We're not too certain yet. This was the race, in my mind, the race around the country. What do you read into that?
Well, you know, reform in Denver, for instance, is a settled, in my mind, a settled question. People are like what they see, that they like the changes that they see in the schools, and that was sort of an easier, not sort of, it was. I mean, they rolled over the union-backed candidates. And I think you're seeing sort of in a more premature form or a earlier form, the same thing happening in Douglas County. There are reforms, people are unsure about them, so it's still pretty fractious. But in another election cycle or two, so long as the school board and the administration perform as promised, you know, you might see those, you know, those positions really solidify, and then I think you see it echo into other counties.
Right. It's interesting that the reform in Denver has a different flavor to it than it does in Dougco, and you know, they both kind of mirror their community.
Well, in Denver, you had a school system that was transparently flawed. Everybody knew that it wasn't working. And so when Michael Bennett came in and then the group of, you know, Democrats for Education Reform, whoever thought we would live long enough
to see that
organization with a name like that. So there's been strong support to continue to improve the schools. I think Dougco was a different situation because they had pretty good schools before the reformers got elected. And actually, I think one of the interesting things is those races were still pretty close down in Douglas County, and I think parents, they want their kids to get a good education, and if the reforms in Douglas County don't produce improvements, I think I'm not convinced that this will be permanent. I think they'll be thrown out.
Well, you know, I think there's also a more political flavor to the school board elections in Douglas County than there was in Denver. I think the administration in Douglas County needs to work hard to kind of tamp that down, because I don't think people really appreciate having politics so imbued in education, at least the perception of it. Right. And if they want to be successful, I think that's one of the things they have to consider.
What was so amazing about Dougco is this is the first school district in the nation that I'm aware of that brought in a voucher program, a scholarship program on the local level. It wasn't jammed down by the state. They're also the first to let their union contract expire, and it goes away. Now they're talking pay for performance. I mean, really pretty impressive stuff. Bring it to Jefferson County, the largest school district in the state, where three reformers have won the elections and might want to do some of those Dougco kind of reforms. First question, do you think Amendment 66 helped those people get into office? Do people look at this? Because remember, Jeffco passed a major mill levy increase just last year, and now they were asked for a huge income tax increase, and they would only get about 50 cents on the dollar of what they were paying back on it.
I think it may have helped in a reaction, and that is that instead of spending the money to support their candidates for the school board, union money was spent to push 66, which was a dead loser coming out of the box. Mm-hmm. And so the inattention to the school board races may have been a price that they paid for supporting 66.
Yeah, that race was, those races out there were a real sleeper, I think. You know, I don't think they really got the attention of a lot of people. The one observation I would make about that race is I hope it isn't an attempt to carbon copy Douglas County reform and the effort of installing it, because Jefferson County is a very different place. It's not Douglas County. It's not as red as Douglas County. The sensibilities are different. There are a lot more poor kids in Jefferson County.
They'll outlaw them. It's not. we take care of that stuff.
Do you live in Jefferson County? Is that what you're saying?
No, but I got influence.
Yeah.
But I'm not living in Colorado Springs.
That's right. Yeah, we all know that. Yeah. It just needs to be a different flavor and style. You know, local control needs to happen.
Well, on 66 is the other issue too, about, you know, when you lose that badly, the proponents had to know at least 6 weeks, maybe longer, before the election, that they were going to get pounded, and instead of shifting their message, or they just kept raising money and telling people that everything's okay.
Don't care. We're going to be fine.
We got this in the bag. That borders on malpractice. If these were doctors or lawyers, somebody would be filing a lawsuit.
Which I've got to say is surprising, because that's something traditionally my team might have done, which is, we're doing fine. You know, and it seems as though my team is starting to wisen up to those things, and this is a mistake that the Hickenlooper, you know, a crowd, I wouldn't expect them to make that. I think they'd say, you know, if we're losing here, we got to do it other places. The Loveland School District now has the reform candidates swept in that election too. It's a much smaller school district, but is it too early to go, oh my God, maybe we are a purple state again?
Well, I mean, I think the school board races are very localized. Yeah. You know, there might be a real feeling that, hey, our kids aren't being served well by this particular school board in this administration. So I think you're seeing people get the idea we can change things if we can control the school board. And they've typically, although not so much recently, but they've typically been low dollar races. So that also is going to change. It's going to continue to be an arms race in terms of campaigning. But it's just going to keep rolling through the state.
And I think that if you vote in a district where there's a sense that the school district's not performing for kids, there's going to be some group that's advocating reform is going to get elected.
Let's switch gears to the fracking bans. Now, so Longmont passes a fracking ban, and the state is going to sue, trying to sue. I haven't really kept up with it. But now four cities had fracking bans on their ballots. It looks like Broomfield is going to be in a tight recount. We don't know if it won or not. It looks like it might have lost by 11 votes. So we'll see. Doesn't this go right back to John Hickenlooper as well? Because as executive of the state, this is afoul of state law. So is he going to have to sue those cities too, or is he going to wait to see what happens in Longmont? I see this as a prelude to something statewide happening on fracking within the next year or so.
Yeah, and I think Hickenlooper should hope that it doesn't come from the legislature, because that would cause a problem for him, you know, in the run-up to his gubernatorial election. It seemed to me, and I've looked at it somewhat carefully, that there really isn't any question that local communities can't ban fracking. You know, I think the precedents are such that it's going to be an uphill battle in a courtroom. You know, I think in terms of politics, Hickenlooper would probably want to see those battles pushed out beyond the election. He doesn't want to countermand, even through his administration, through a lawsuit in a courtroom, doesn't want to countermand those voters.
But he gets this. The guy's a geologist.
Yeah.
You know, he's trained in this stuff. The man drank fracking fluid. You know, he knows this is not the scare that it's made out to be. Are you telling me that politically he can't push this as hard and as fast as he'd like?
Well, I think it's out of his hands. I think that there will be a ballot initiative put on with signatures. So it's going to be there in November of next year. And if John's the Democratic candidate, you're going to have two candidates for governor who are going to be saying vote no. I think the real issue for the oil and gas community is that they got to learn how to talk about this in a way that people can understand. I saw the ads on TV that said something about in Broomfield and Fort Collins, this isn't part of our energy plan. I had to get on the phone and ask somebody, is this about the fracking initiative? I mean, it was so abstruse, the opponents.
It's because oil and gas guys are engineers. They like numbers. There's no emotion. They just go, look at the graph. Why can't you read the graph? I agree. They haven't been able to connect. They also haven't built any sort of infrastructure to work on that, whereas the left over the last several decades, you know, whether it's Koperg or Environment Colorado or Sierra Club, you know, they build a movement and make it ripe for this to happen. And I would imagine if they put that on the ballot and today we voted on it, there'd be a statewide fracking ban, and the industry has a lot to blame for that. They've done nothing to countermand that over the years.
Well, I think what people don't understand, I heard a speaker the other day on this, and he said, you know, oil exploration is no longer a risky business. He said it's like farming, it's like agriculture. You show me where the shale is, I'll drill it, frack it, and I'll pump it out. And the public doesn't understand that yet.
And I think part of it is the fragmented nature of oil and gas work. You know, for instance, when coal mines were were a big source of energy, I mean they still are, but and they were part of the community in which they were located. Oil and gas really hasn't, for reasons, logistical reasons, but also they just haven't done enough, I think, to connect with communities.
Which is odd because the environmental damage from poking one hole in the ground compared to cleaning out a whole mine.
Hillside,
hillside for coal is amazing. All right, 30 seconds left. Any big surprises coming up that we haven't seen legislative?
Oh, yeah, and that is always a surprise in the next legislature. I can't tell you
what it
is.
I don't know that it would be a surprise, but I think there'll be some sort of oil and gas fracking measure that comes through.
And let me tell you,
anti-fracking.
John Hickenlooper's not going to like that one.
No.
Alicia, thank you. Miller, thank you, and thank you. Hey, listen for me on KHOW Radio. Check out the Independence Institute. That's independenceinstitute.org. Tell a friend. We'll see you next week.